Thrive 2050 Montgomery County, which is the most recent proposal to reimagine the suburbs of Montgomery County, and is set to be voted on by the county council very soon. Carrie, there was a listening session this past Tuesday. What was the outcome?
Not very good. I mean, like this entire process, you know, the counties kind of excluded the public and made it more difficult. When we testify, it's not 3 minutes we get 2 minutes. This past listening session came out on the day of Hanukkah, right? 50% of the people that requested to testify, they were turned down. They testified on the planning draft proposal, but this is the Fed committee proposal, totally different document supposedly, but we lose our rights apparently. And out of that listening session, a great many people who were approved to testify didn't testify because they were observing Hanukkah. You know, so, throughout this process, it's been like this.
Well, I think that's the key point. And I think, you know, many people who have been following this issue for the last 2 years feel that this plan came about during the COVID session, when people were hunkered down and thinking about other important things and not zoning issues or reimagining the suburbs. And really, the public hasn't been bought in on this. And Mark, one of the key components of Thrive 2050 is to encourage affordable housing. But when you read through it, how is that going to be accomplished?
Well, it's built from a premise that I'm not sure that stands up to scrutiny, that the price of the affordable housing will be cheaper by converting existing land to multiple dwellings. The market is going to respond, and I take the example that's sometimes cited by the council members of Pike and Rose, which is those are expensive houses, expensive, is certainly market rate and appropriately so, but I think it's being oversold as the idea that somehow costs will be lower because of higher density. That does not stand up to scrutiny. I'd also point out, I mean, across the street from where Casey is, I'm not sure I'm giving it away, there's a lot of former commercial land that's available in Montgomery County, not single family homes, that's available for development that might be appropriate for allowing for multiple dwellings. And that could well be, and it's something which there's more buy-in from the public than this plan to strip away so many single family homes.
Well, you know, I'll just a comment on the White Flint development plans. I mean, the White Flint development plans still have a large amount of commercial office and lab space, you know, as part of their program, and not as much residential as you might once think. But Carrie, I want to go to you and real quickly, one of the disturbing trends that we saw in the run-up of of housing prices this past year that we heard about was how big corporations are buying up residential houses and keeping people out of the market. Will this 2050 Thrive plan address that issue about developers buying up residential?
No, in fact, it changes our direction from the wedges and corridor plan. When you talk about the market, it creates an entirely new market of developer and speculators that are buying up old existing homes, displacing people, or has the potential to do that, and building these multiplex housing units. You know, if I'm a business person and I own a residential property, you know, that in, let's say, Wheaton or Glenmont or whatever, and I, instead of renting it for $1,500 a month and I can get three units for $1,800, $2,000 a month, I'm gonna do it. And that's what this market does. That's what this new paradigm of growth does. It alters the reality. It brings in international investors and national investors. And, you know, they said it's exclusionary zoning, but the same developers and realtors that created that exclusionary zoning in the 40s are now using that argument to create this new paradigm of growth that will actually displace people of color. White, I mean, it's anyone who's in the lower economic rung, I'm sorry, it makes it more difficult for you.
Well, I want to follow up with you on this because, sure, you know, minority home ownership has increased in Montgomery County since 1970, when it was only 10%, to 43% today. It would seem to me that the market is adjusting, and isn't the market going to solve this problem of economic segregation?
You know, a lot of scholars, you know, did address upzoning would argue that if you use upzoning as a tool, right, and don't try to blanket upzoning and target it where in areas where you can say create affordable housing, yes, then the market would react. You got to remember, we've already got 44,800 development units approved in the pipeline. That's housing for over 100,000 people right there. And they've targeted it, or they have identified 85,000 additional units here in Montgomery County. That's before we do any upzoning. So, you know.
Well, it occurs to me that the population of the county is also changing. I mean, we are no longer a majority white county.
Right.
And I don't know if when you're looking at it in the faculty lounge that comes into effect. Mark, how does Thrive 2050 Montgomery interact with a Biden administration proposal called the Homes Act, which has been roundly unpopular with homeowners?
Well, you mentioned the faculty room issue, which is a kind of great way to describe it. Look, single family occupancy homes is really the aspiration of broadly with among Americans. Obviously, there's room for others, but that is something that there is a great deal of support for, and which folks are willing to sacrifice either by long commutes or economic sacrifice in order to accomplish. And one of the challenges is among the faculty lounge set is there's a great deal of skepticism about that model. They would rather have people in more densely more densely packed housing and using mass public transportation, mass transit, as opposed to getting cars. And it flies in the face of what people actually want. And we see how people respond to that by leapfrogging to jurisdictions farther and farther away, Frederick County and even into West Virginia now.
So I'm a little country lawyer, and I do a lot of real estate settlements, and I do a lot of estate work. And I know how important to my clients that home ownership is, and especially new immigrants to the United States. They value their properties, and they want to make sure it can stay in their family. Carrie, I'm going to let you have the last word on 2050 Thrive program.
Look, we need affordable housing. The COG report said that 75% of the future residents that are coming to the county are going to be in that lower economic rung. It's disproportionate between employment, we're growing at a 0.24%, and our housing rate, which we're growing at a 0.66%. That's problematic in and of itself because it's unsustainable. Look, we've got to be creative. We've got to find a solution, but a blanket upzoning, I'm sorry, it doesn't work, especially if we don't address the issues in the action report.
Well, no one likes my suggestion, which is open up the parts of the ag reserve for development. Look, Carrie's shaking his head. So I know that's unpopular, but we all agree we need more density and we need more affordable housing. When we come back from this short break, if Roe v. Wade is overturned, how will it affect us here in Maryland? Stay tuned.